Here's how I made four LED poles for a recent art performance here in New York City. The project brief, as it was pitched to me, was to create four tall uprights for the corners of an 8-foot by 8-foot raft. They needed to be quick to deploy and start up the animation on their own after a 5-minute countdown timer. And just in case anything were to fail, the show must go on without human intervention, so they needed to have as much redundancy as possible built into the design. So I came up with a set of four independent circuits, one on each pole, each containing a strip of pixels that will go up the pole and then over to the top of its neighbor, with some slack to drape in between the uprights. Kind of like an LED chuppah. Oh, and I had 1 week before the show to build everything, so this is a speed project. The circuits each consist of a whole reel of RGB WS2812B NeoPixel strip, along with its recommended capacitor and data line resistor, a microcontroller to drive the pixels, and a USB battery pack. This project was short notice, so I used whatever Arduino-compatible boards I had around the workshop already. So even though you wouldn't normally solder to a board with female headers like this Metro, it's still doable. It's strongly recommended to add this extra capacitor when doing projects with long runs of adjustable LEDs to help smooth out the power spikes. It matters more for circuits connected to AC adapters, but it also can't hurt. And these strips come with extra power and ground wires that are perfect for just this purpose. Likewise, with the resistor hooked up between the Arduino's output pin and the data input on the first pixel, even if there is one already, doubling up can't hurt. I loaded up the NeoPixel strand test program on each of my four circuits, adjusting the sample code to increase the number of LEDs in the strand and decrease the brightness so the total power draw stays within the limit of the battery pack. Now that the circuits were assembled and tested, it's time to switch focus to the physical structure. At the output end of the strip, I needed to create a leash for attaching to the neighboring pole. So I took an elastic hair tie and zip tied it to the end of the strip, just below the knuckle that's formed by the silicone end cap. Then I became concerned the elastics wouldn't be strong enough and installed a redundant piece of paracord in the same way. I picked up four pieces of electrical conduit at my local big box store, then measured and marked them for cutting down to length. I don't have a garage or easy outdoor space for this task, so I just used a piece of scrap wood to cut against with my angle grinder fitted with a cutoff wheel. I also cut notches in the ends of the strip because I thought they could be used for attaching the ends of the loose LED strips. I removed the sharp edges on my belt sander and wrapped the top ends in electrical tape, thinking it would buffer the cord from rubbing against the still sort of sharp on the inside metal. Next, it was time to affix the circuits to the poles, which I did using zip ties and electrical tape in between the LEDs. I left some bare metal at the bottom of the poles to stick into the holes on the raft. Once I had all four assembled, I stood them upright in my studio to start working on the animation. In the code, the first thing I tackled was the startup delay. I used Arduino's built-in timer called milliseconds, which is always equal to the number of milliseconds since the program started running. I can compare this to a variable I define as my startup delay and only proceed with the show when it's time. But it's helpful to be able to tell that the circuit is working during this 5-minute countdown, so I also wrote a little function to flash a few LEDs once per second during this time. It will light up one pixel for each minute that is left on the timer. For instance, at 5 minutes, 5 pixels will flash, then 4, then 3, and so on, so you can tell approximately how much time is left before the show will start. As with all my projects, you can find a step-by-step tutorial at the link in the description, which will have a complete supplies list and all the code you'll need to replicate this project on your own. And if you're a beginner, I've got a whole teaching series that will bring you up to speed over on DigiKey, the sponsor of this video. My series on the DigiKey channel will introduce you to LEDs, Arduino, soldering, programming, and more, so that you can level up your skills and build rad LED projects of your own. Also, DigiKey carries everything you need to make this project, and they ship super fast. One of the best ways you can support me is to shop with my sponsors. Huge thanks to DigiKey for their continued support of my channel. Now, back to it. The whole art piece has a fireworks theme to it, so I programmed an animation with a flame effect, and then some random flashing in the same colors. It's not exactly the most sophisticated NeoPixel show ever created, but it was finished on time and did its job. I delivered the polls to the group and eagerly awaited the performance. It was an anniversary celebration for the Madagascar Institute. You might remember them from the jet ponies and chariot races at Maker Faire New York in 2010, or the dueling mechanical bulls I made a video about here on my channel. From what I could tell from the audience, everything with the deployment of the poles went according to plan.
So, a bunch of people who had never done anything together before. Not artists, just people. People maybe like you, perhaps younger and better looking than you all are, definitely better than me, but, you know, we just got together to try something. Did we know how to do anything? No. Did that stop us or even slow us down? No. This was the days before cell phones where, you know, we're doing like written communication and people actually had to be someplace when they said they were gonna be. We had everything perfectly planned. Everything. Except that we're doing it on the waterfront in mid-February. It was cold. You think this is cold now? You kids don't know what cold is. It was the coldest day ever. Which means hundreds of people showed up because they're just like, hey, something going on, right? I don't know what it is, but word got around. It doesn't cost anything. Let's go. So 300 people showed up. They came down to the waterfront, and was it ready? No. I mean, it's hard to imagine that we're not running exactly on time ever, but it happened. All in all, no one could hear what was happening. The sound design sucked. Timing sucked. It was horrible. It was a horrible failure. It was also one of the best things that's happened in my life. And maybe in yours too, because it showed people that, hey, just do it. You know, how hard can this be? Turns out very, very hard. Cannot recommend. But tonight we're going to be doing a reenactment of that. And the lights going on means it's going to start in very shortly.
After the performance, the raft materials were reclaimed, and I was able to bring them back to my studio. There wasn't exactly a huge budget for this project, so reclaiming the salvageable materials will help reduce the overall cost. This project was a rare opportunity for me to test my construction methods against some tough conditions, and I learned some things from inspecting the poles after the show. The most noticeable thing was that the zip ties can slip on smooth surfaces, and they did on the batteries. The electrical tape was much better for this purpose, so I'm glad that I used both. Next, it's the methods by which the pixel strip was broken or damaged. The LEDs affixed to the poles had no issues, but the long tails took some damage along their lengths, as well as at the transition from the pole to the free-hanging LED strip. See, the silicone sheathing is more stretchy than the pixel strip, so when the whole thing was pulled, the strip inside pulled apart before the silicone was done stretching. At the tops of the poles, my attempt to soften the strip's transition by adding a stiff zip tie tail to the joint seems to have worked well, but I shouldn't have cut the silicone sheathing to do it, because the small hole I made to insert the plastic quickly ripped open wider and weakened the whole area. But I'll definitely have a use for these lengths of LEDs down the line, either in a future project or to give to my students for their annual LED Halloween costume midterm assignment. So overall, I'm happy with how little waste this project generated. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and share it with a friend. I hope you'll subscribe with the bell to be notified of my future uploads, subscribe to my email newsletter, and find me on your favorite social platforms. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. This video was made with support from my sponsors and generous donations from viewers like you through Patreon and YouTube memberships.